For this project, you will need to have downloaded the Stealth project files. You can download them from the Downloads area of the tutorial site. The first thing we'll do is make a new scene. Go to File, New Scene. Then go to File, Save Scene As, and save it into the Scenes folder, and call it Stealth with a capital S. Now we need to drag the level geometry into the hierarchy so that it appears in the scene. In the Models folder, locate the model called env, short for environment, stealth static. It looks like this. Drag and drop this into the hierarchy. It should be positioned at 000, the origin of the 3D world, but if it's not, click the cog on the right and choose reset. That's almost all of the geometry, but there's one important part missing. In the Models folder, locate Prop Battle Bus. It looks like this. Drag and drop this into the hierarchy too. You'll notice that it's not in the right place. We need to place it into the parking bay in the center of the map. Place it at position -11, 0, 17.5, using the transform component in the inspector. Then, rotate it by 270 degrees in the y-axis. Your battle bus should now look like this. Next, we need to add a collision mesh to the scene to give it a physical presence. So highlight env stealth static in the hierarchy, and using the add component button on the inspector, go to physics and mesh collider. The mesh we want to use is a separate simplified version of the scene called env stealth collision. When you select it, it should look like this. Expand the FBX file to reveal the mesh underneath. Then, with env stealth static selected in the hierarchy, drag the mesh to the mesh property of the collider. The next thing to deal with is lighting. We're going to use a mixture of baked and dynamic light, but before we get started, we need to change some settings in the scene. We're going to start by making the environment static. This tells Unity that this game object won't move and can therefore be light mapped. Highlight Env Stealth Static and Prop Battle Bus in the hierarchy, and then click the static checkbox in the top right of the inspector. You'll then be asked whether you want child objects of what you've selected to be static. We do, so choose yes. The environment is made up of two parts, the play area and the extents. We're going to set some layers for them so that they can be affected by lights appropriately. Open the environment hierarchy and select every child object except for the extents. Then also select the prop battle bus. We'll set these to the layer called play area. And again, you'll be asked if you want to apply this layer to the child objects, and we do, so choose yes. Finally, choose the extents and set it to the layer called extents. And choose yes when prompted. For neatness and consistency, we've established a naming convention in this project, and we're going to rename the camera as such. Change the main camera game object's name to camera_main. We're also going to set up the camera to render with deferred lighting. Under the rendering path setting in the camera component, choose deferred lighting. We also want to change the camera's background color to black. So under background, click on the color block and then drag down to black and close the color picker. Finally, we want to make sure that the camera is not trying to render too much. So we'll change the far clipping plane to 100 instead of 1000. This also improves accuracy of rendering. Now we're going to add lights to the scene. The lighting for the scene is time consuming, and so we've designed the majority of the lighting and provided it for you as a prefab. Don't worry, you'll learn how to light what we've left out later. Drag in the Lights Baked prefab from the Prefabs folder and drop it into the hierarchy panel. If it's not already, ensure that the position is 000. Now, when looking at our scene, we can choose to show the lighting by clicking on the sun icon at the top of the scene view. And you should also be aware that if you aren't using 3D gizmos, then you can toggle using the gizmos dropdown of the right-hand side at the top of the scene view, and you can also scale the gizmos there. Bear in mind that you'll also see controls for the lights when selecting them, so if you don't want to see all these overlays, simply click off them in the hierarchy. You should also be aware that if the scene is performing badly whilst working in Unity, you can toggle built-in lighting off in the scene view to have it perform a lot more quickly, and then simply toggle it back on when you want to check your lighting. To complete the lighting for the scene, we need to create some lights for the room that's currently unlit. You'll find it in the lower right corner of the map. It looks like this. Start by creating a point light. Click on the Create button on the hierarchy and choose Point Light. Using the Translate tool, position it within the room. We'll start with the first of three, somewhere like this. To keep with our naming convention, we'll rename this point light light_playArea_point. Next, we're going to adjust the colour of the light to a yellow colour. This should feel more like a real light bulb than white light. Click the colour block on the light component, and then choose a yellowish light, something like that. Note the values that I have in R, G, B, and A whenever you're trying to copy a colour that I have in a tutorial. Now we'll reduce the range slightly. Currently it looks a little bit intense, so we'll change that down to a value of 8. The last setting we need to change is the light mapping setting. We need to make sure that this light is baked only. Otherwise it will be rendered as real-time and affect performance. Under light mapping, change auto to baked only. We're going to have two more lights in this room to make sure it's lit properly. These lights are going to be the same as the one we've just made, so we'll duplicate them and place them appropriately in the room. Select the point light and either go to Edit, Duplicate, or use Command D on Mac or Control D on PC. Now we have two lights in the same location, so again we can use the Translate tool and drag the Z-axis to move it along slightly. We'll move this one to the center of the room and duplicate once more and drag this to the end of the room. If you'd like, play around with the settings for color and range to get a lighting that you're more happy with. When you're finished, drag and drop these lights onto the Lights Baked object to keep them organized in the hierarchy that we already have. You can then collapse this back up. Next, we need to change the render settings. These are found under Edit, Render Settings. Change them to the values shown here. First, we'll enable fog. We'll give it a purple color. We'll change the density to 0.04. We'll set the linear start to 3, the end to 24, and we'll set ambient light to black. Next, we need to change some of the quality settings. These can be found under Edit, Project Settings, Quality. For the purpose of this tutorial project, we recommend choosing Beautiful or Fantastic, but if you find that you suffer from lower performance, you can choose Good and up the number of pixel lights to a minimum of 6. We'll be exporting this as a web player or standalone, so remember to set these as a default under those two platforms, the first column representing web and the second representing standalone. Click on the arrow under default and choose Beautiful for both of these, or Good depending on your hardware. Next, we come to baking the light map. Baking the light map is a process of saving all of our lighting to a texture, and we do this in the light mapping window. If you don't have your light mapping window open already, go to Window, Light Mapping. With the light mapping window open, click on the Bake tab at the top. Start by setting the mode to directional light maps. For now, set the quality to low. We'll do a high quality bake later. Set the number of bounces to 4. Set Bounce Boost to 0.5, leaving Intensity at 1. Set the Contrast Threshold to 0.05. Set Interpolation to 0.25. Set Interpolation Points to 30. Ambient Occlusion to 1. Max Distance for the Ambient Occlusion to 0.25. Contrast to 0. And at the bottom, set resolution to 30 texels per world unit, and set the padding to 2. Whilst this is a lot of detailed setting, you can see the light mapping documentation via the link below this video. Now we can bake the scene. Click Bake Scene at the bottom. This will take a few minutes. You may wish to pause the video now and continue once your bake is finished. Once you click Bake Scene, you'll see progress bars saying Exporting, and then a further progress bar in the bottom right of the Unity interface. Once your bake is finished, you'll see an Assets progress bar as it imports the textures for the light map that it's created. Next, we need to make a light to dynamically light the player, so that the player can cast shadows. Create a new directional light game object by going to Create on the Hierarchy panel and choosing Directional Light. Name the light light_main_directional. We want to reference this light in code so that we can fade it when the alarm is going off. This way the alarm light won't be interfered with. To reference it, we're going to use a tag. From the inspector, choose the tag Main Light. We now want to tweak the settings for the light slightly. We want the game to have quite a dark atmosphere, so we'll change this light's colour to a blue-grey colour. If you want to copy the exact colour we're going to use, set the colour to 33, 45, 48. Close the colour picker. Now we'll set the shadows to soft shadows. We're going to tweak the shadow settings slightly so that the bias is 0.01. Softness is 4 and the softness fade is 0.8. The bias is a setting that represents how far from objects the shadow starts. Values that are too low will produce artifacts, and values that are too high will mean that the objects appear to be hovering. The softness is how harsh the lines of the shadow are, and the softness fade is a measure of how far from the camera soft shadows are drawn. The last tweak we need to make to the light component itself is to affect what layers are on its culling mask. The culling mask is a list of layers that the light will affect. We don't need this light to affect the extents layer, so we'll deselect it from the culling mask. Click on the culling mask dropdown and deselect extents by clicking on it. The last change we want to make to this light is to change its rotation, so that it's casting a shadow in a more visually pleasing direction. Change the rotation to 45, 305, 0. You'll now see these shadows in the scene view. And remember that with a directional light, the position is irrelevant, only the rotation matters. Next, we need to make a light that will show red when the alarm is going off. This will also be a directional light and will share a lot of the same settings that we've just done for the main light. So we'll simply duplicate this to make the alarm light. Select it and do Command D or Control D on PC, or go to Edit, Duplicate. We'll rename this light_alarm_directional. Again, we're going to need to reference this game object through code, so we're going to tag it. Use the Tag drop-down menu and choose Alarm Light. We also want to tweak the settings of this light. This time our aim is to make an imposing red glow so that the player knows that they're in trouble. Let's start with changing the colour to a dark red. Click on the colour and choose red, then copy our settings, 70, 0, 0. Then close the colour picker. Since the alarm won't be on at the start of the game, set the intensity to 0. We also want to affect the extents of this light, so we need to change our culling mask back to everything. Under Culling Mask, click the drop-down and choose Everything to reselect the extents. The last thing we want to do with these lights is to change their light mapping settings. We already have a preliminary bake of the light map, but we're going to do a high-quality bake later on. We don't want these lights to be included in the bake, so we're going to change them to real-time only. Highlight both the alarm light and the main light in the hierarchy, and then set light mapping to real-time only. And that's it for this assignment. Move on to the next one to start learning how to code the alarm systems. Remember to save your scene before moving on. Go to File, Save Scene.